So we have a very interesting panel for you guys, and we're basically going to be talking about money. We're going to be talking about how you can get funded as a startup with increasing interest coming to the Middle East and from the international companies. So these lovely people, these lovely gentlemen, are going to tell us their opinions and what startups can do in order to get Series A investments, basically. I'll hand the mic over to Rami.
Hello, thank you. Okay, before we start, I would like to see more energy in the crowd. So I need to take a selfie, a picture of you guys going crazy so that we can see the more energy, more energy. Aha! Cool, okay. Yeah, of course. Once we get the internet again, we'll see it online. Okay, so the tech scene has been going through very interesting phases. The momentum that I'm seeing in the region is super interesting. I've had both the blessings and the curse of being part of helping shape this ecosystem in the region. So I have a few scars, but I've done some work in helping corporates, basically, and investment houses get more value out of building the ecosystem. And I've recently done some work with one of the telecoms in Jordan, where we helped build something called the Zain Innovation Campus, where it's basically a platform to build more density around the ecosystem. And what we're all trying to see or move towards in this region is seeing more and more startups move from idea to stage, then growth, then liquidity, whatever pace we take across this growth. And historically, we've all known that there's a liquidity issue in the region. And now we're seeing more and more interesting stuff happening, like people reaching the Series A and more. And with this panel, we'll be a bit more focused on, let's say, demystifying some of the interesting parts that we're seeing, where some investment is actually coming into the region from out of the region, which is hopefully helping us head towards an interesting space. So today we will be having a chat with our friends on the panel, some who are investors that directed their investments into the region, and some who basically managed to go through their current Series A. We hope to see B and C up till Z. Hopefully you guys will be unicorns before before having to go public. So let me just quickly, for starters, give the floor to each of the panelists to just briefly tell us a bit background on themselves and some interesting, maybe two, three words on why are they on the panel, be it their company, how did it reach Series A, and what have you. So let's do that in that order. Maybe Sharif, you can start.
Okay. Thank you, Rami. So I'm Sharif from Yauta. I founded the company with my partner Mohammed Awais last year. We launched last year. It's basically a shopping search engine.
Can we call it the Google Shopping of the region? Is that okay? Or
it's okay. You can call it Google Shopping.
Okay.
It's not as big as Google yet, so. But
we're there. We're heading there.
It's basically a platform, a price comparison website, an aggregator in which you can go and search, compare, and buy different products. We're currently still in Egypt, but we're planning to expand quite soon. The reason why I'm on the panel, probably because we've recently raised $2.7 million from KBBO as a Series A. Yeah, and I hope I can
back to the energy insight. Thing. This guy just raised 2.1. Just let's see some.
So don't use that analogy on me, Rami. So I'm from Kareem. I started Kareem, for some of you who don't know. It's the region's largest car booking service. We're available on the app. There is a company in San Francisco that looks a bit like us, but we are so much better for the region for them. And we are now in 22 cities, all the way from Morocco on the west to Pakistan on the east. Majority of our business comes from the Gulf, and Cairo, for those of you who haven't heard, is our fastest growing market, and it's growing faster than any other place by a multiple of 2 to 3. And that's Kareem's Cairo team sitting right here. So thanks for all the hard work that they have done to bring us this far. And I guess the reason I'm on the panel is we have raised about $72 million. And bulk of it, the 60 of it came in just last month. So we closed a $60 million Series C with Abraaj Capital in the lead.
Lovely. Mabruk.
Thank you.
Vero, please. Alvaro Abella from Beko Capital. We're a Dubai-based venture capital firm. And instead of telling you my background, I guess I'll just tell you a story uh-huh. that maybe some people don't know. I was actually in venture capital back in the first Web 1.0. And we burned through $15 million of JP Morgan money quite quickly. But interesting lessons learned from that. And I think the biggest lesson was, you know what, maybe the world really wasn't ready for this big tech disruption. And you know, it's just going to be business as usual. And when I started talking with my present partners about building Beko about 3 years ago, I still had a little bit of that doubt in my mind from Web 1.0. And actually, that trip, this journey over the past 3 years here in the Middle East, has definitely more and more proven that we're in a complete different ballgame. Ahmed Alfi, if you heard him on the previous panel at 1 o'clock, was saying that 2016 is going to be much better than 2015. I strongly believe that it's going to be much better as we move forward in terms of funding, in terms of quality of entrepreneurs, in terms of the companies that venture capitalists can fund.
Inshallah.
Just as a measure, in the U.S., I think they raised 2014 around 50 some billion, which by any measure sounds like a big number, but it was really only about 5% of all S&P dividends. Not much in terms of allocation to real innovation. Here, if you compare it to the region, we did a little bit of a study on that. It was below 1%. It was actually around 0.4%. So we have a long way to go. We have to instruct and we have to teach not only entrepreneurs, that's probably part of growing up in the ecosystem, but more importantly, the institutional investors that are still not there in our region, and they're busy buying hotels and real estate abroad. They're going to come back to this region. Just you wait.
Cool. Bjorn?
Yeah. So I'm Bjorn. I'm part of the investment team at Vostok New Ventures, investment company based out of Stockholm, Sweden. We invest in online marketplaces and businesses with strong network effects, as we call it, on a global emerging market base. And I guess I'm on the panel as we've been quite active in the region this year and invested in Vostok, their Series A.
Vostok is a 500 startup company
exactly.
as well.
Yeah.
And you did what, 1.7?
Yeah, so the round was 1.7. We did one of those, 1 million from us. Really happy to be here. I think Egypt and the region is always very exciting time right now.
Cool. So let me start with you with the so no deals back home at Sweden. Why are you guys investing here?
Yeah, so Vostok has always been focused on the more messier market. You might call them then Western Europe and Sweden. So initially we did Russia and Eastern Europe, and then more recently we've gone global. So we've been here, Egypt, Pakistan, all the rest of the region here in the MENA. And I guess what we look for is, you know, very nice risk reward properties. And
but quickly, roughly, how many deals did you see before investing in Wazif? Once you agreed or you looked into it, what's the time frame? Just give us a time frame between first meeting and the signed term sheet.
Yeah, sure. So we met Amir at the Osof in first connect was in February, I think. And we're a small team, so we're only four people. I guess we closed it in late March, early April. We're quite fast when we see something we like, especially when we find an entrepreneur we like. That's probably the most important thing for us, especially as we're based in Stockholm and don't have feet on the ground here. You need to find a partner that you really trust. So the entrepreneur is everything.
So I'm currently doing the Geeks on a Plane tour, and couple of days ago, we were in Dubai and we visited Property Finder. And both of you, I think, are investors with the Property Finder site, right? So tell us a bit more on maybe Alvaro, you can tell us a bit more on co-investing with the funds you that are stepping in, and your then we can step into your deal with Kareem. And
so this is a very important point, I think, for also the stage of where we find ourselves in the development of our ecosystem. And I think Ahmed Alfi, it wasn't Ahmed Alfi, it was Christopher Schroeder's at the previous panel, says the good thing is that there are no assholes in this ecosystem. Everybody wants to co-invest alongside everybody. Why? Because unfortunately, and this is I think the reality and something that they didn't mention, is investors do have a very strong focus on risk return. And specifically a lot of us who are paranoid, Andy Grove said, you know, only the paranoid survive, but who are a little bit paranoid about risk, they want to see who are the other guys that are going to be investing, whether you're leading around, who's going to be investing afterwards, or if you co-invest, you're sort of sharing, you know, any downside potential and actually also the burden, because once you are in, you have to do a lot of, you have to help out. It's not just capital. If you're talking to investors who are telling you, oh, we'll give you some cash and you report to us on a quarterly basis and then we'll see you next year, that's not the type of investor you want. You want somebody that you can call on to help you out. And for that, you need people who are active. And hence, I think in our region, at our stage of development, we have to be able to find and create links and bridges to other like-minded investors that can help out throughout the growth stage. A company that is growing 600% year on year, you cannot, you know, just put all the burden on management. Everybody has to help out. I don't know if you agree on that.
So, Mudassar, I basically, we all fly frequently, so we're always on the plane. So I'm used to this service that I used to use earlier, local cab service. That I call up at least 12 hours earlier, and they come pick me up. And most of the cases, they mess up, and I have to have a backup plan. And then Uber comes along, and you wish for luck that there's a driver when you need him. And then you come up with your model where you can book cars later. This driver shows up with a neat car, excellent service. You can pay in cash, you can pay in credit, which is not available. So walk us through the story. How did you think of something that is a bit different than Uber while Uber is doing their stuff? You came in and you basically came up with a very interesting model to grow a different service that is within the same space. And what led you to up to the growth of a Series A?
So for us, when we started, that was back in 2012. And I think Uber was there, but it was quite restricted to the US. It wasn't a big deal as it is today. And that really wasn't the inspiration to starting Kareem. You know, I think as some of you know that we were management consultants prior to doing Kareem. And as management consultants, a lot of them in the region were based out of Dubai. And then we were traveling to Saudi, to Kuwait, to Egypt to basically do our work. And one of the biggest frustrations for us as we were traveling was, how do you get a car reliably every time that would know where to pick you up from, where to drop you, and you would not miss meetings and miss flights. So that really was the problem statement for us. How do we make life easy for people like us who are constantly on the go? And when we dug into the problem a bit deeper, we realized that the problem was not just for passengers like us who were traveling, but our assistants or travel teams that were making the bookings, they were struggling to find reliable partners. The finance team that was doing the reconciliation was also struggling to make sure that things were allocated to the right charge codes. So for us, it was a local problem. This is something that we had experienced, and we built the service to solve a problem that we were having ourselves. And the growth of Kareem and the fact that we were able to successfully defend and outcompete Uber in this region was primarily, in my opinion, a function of solving local problems. You know, yes, you can get inspired by what others are doing, but at the end of the day, you need to look at the people that will be using your service on the ground, the customers, the captains, or the drivers, as they're normally called, and understand what their needs are and how can you develop a product that will meet those needs. So for us, pre-scheduling, very simple. As consultants, we needed an ability to pre-schedule. We have call centers for both customers and captains, which is not available in other places because this region people actually feel comfortable calling someone and getting someone on the phone, whether to make a booking or when things go wrong. We have built our own maps for the region because the maps that exist, like Google Maps and others, are not reliable for the region, cash payments and so forth. So you really have to understand the people that you're trying to serve and develop a product that will meet the needs of that segment. And that's really what causes growth.
And operationally, what I don't want to say what went wrong, but you know what I mean. When you started to grow, definitely there's, did you bite more than you can chew? How did you?
As always, right? So, you know, failures are the best learnings. So I think, you know, we didn't know anything about transport when we started. So there were a ton of failures, even at the beginning product development stages. But every failure was an opportunity to learn from and develop the product that would not make that failure happen again. And after we had developed the first thing that looked like a product market fit when things started taking off, then scaling is a challenge, right? And for a startup with limited resources in the region to scale is not easy in the sense that we were always doing enough to last the next 2 months. And then the next 2 months we were breaking again and the next 2 months and the next 2 months and the next 2 months. So it was always like, let's just engineer enough to give us another round of growth and then we'll come back and fix it again. And then we'll come back and fix it again. But the focus was on growth. And I think back to what, every time we had a decision to make that should we focus on growth or should we focus on raising money or should we focus on doing other things, the focus was no, growth is the priority. If we get growth happening, then everything else will fall in place. We'll get the resources, we'll get the investors, they'll give us the money to fix things. But the growth should be a constant priority. And growth happens by listening to the market and developing what the market needs.
Sharif, I'll let you talk a bit about Yauta, but I need you to move within your discussion towards, again, the operational part. And maybe tell us a bit more on, you currently teach, right? You still teach or did you?
Actually, this term, I don't really have time, so.
So
part-time.
So you started this while teaching?
Yes.
And you're also the CTO and CEO of the company?
Yes.
So how are you managing this from an operational point of view? And was this an issue, raising money? Did they tell you focus a bit more, hire a CTO? Did you go through similar discussions? Because I need you to go through this a bit and then tell us a bit more on if you needed to do any governance, restructure, operational, and what have you.
You mean post-closing?
Post-closing.
Okay. This actually wasn't an issue, and I'm going to tell you why. Our investors, and that's what I basically like about them most, is that they belong to the type of investors that really, really focus on the team. So the key reason why they chose us, and that's what they told us actually, is the team. You put the trust in the team, and you see what they've done. You see, of course, the growth figures, and then you try not to interfere or to interfere as little as possible. They're there if you need help, of course, because they're well connected, but they wouldn't get into day-to-day operations because their strategy, not only in this investment but with others as well, is you've probably been obsessed with your startups day in, day out for 3 years. You definitely understand more about the startup than we do. So that's the thinking behind it. They've seen that things are going very well, that I can wear different hats between CTO, CEO, and so forth. So this was really a point that we discussed. There was nothing about it. That's
no
the positive.
Tell us a bit more about the story and how you developed the company into the growth phase.
So when we started back then, it was pretty much a prototype that I developed myself during free time. I believe that you were with Booze as well, right?
McKinsey,
okay. So we're competitors basically, but not anymore. and then the proof of concept, the prototype, turned out to be very working pretty well. So I touched base with my current partner and friend Mohammed. We've known each other since school, so he wasn't someone that I didn't know. And he was in right away. We started hiring people and developing the product at a larger scale. And we've seen that or noticed that the growth is quite strong. So what we did is we didn't seek any investment at the beginning. We put on pretty much our the entire our entire savings to float for around 2.5 years until we found the, or closed the investment. So it was pretty tough, I have to say, financially, of course. But we believed in the company and definitely helped us. So one thing I would definitely give as an advice for people who are seeking money, you're most likely underestimating the period of time that you need to finance yourself or keep afloat. Pretty much most of them are doing that. I would say at least, and this would be probably a very optimistic scenario, 2.5 to 3 years until you reach Series A. And you have to have very, very good numbers in terms of growth. Because it wasn't as fast as with you guys, unfortunately. It took us exactly 11 months between handshaking, but pre-negotiations. So handshaking, yes, we're interested, we're going to look into the company, and the money actually getting in, 11 months. So
That's the norm, by the way.
So. Yes, that's the norm. Actually, I know people who close in close to 2 years. That's specifically in the region.
18 to 24. That's
yes. That's so I mean, imagine if I start today working on my product. Let's say I have something working in a year. I need at least 6 months to 1 year to gain traction to go to an investor and show something. So we have already 2 years plus the 11 months or 1 year. You're talking about 3 years minimum until you have the money getting in. So we have to talk to family, friends, get seed funding, put all your money into the company. You have to make sure that you bridge that time, so you don't have to close before you find an investor. That's something I definitely would give as an advice.
During those 11 months, did you feel any time where you thought, this is not going anywhere?
It wasn't that bad, but almost that bad. The thing is, the investors are quite, our investors specifically are quite busy because they're a small team and they have a lot of investments. And there was a lot going on in terms of, I mean, politically in the country. So while we were at the negotiation phase, there were some times of radio silence, basically. So we had to push, I had to drive myself to Sharm el Sheikh at that point to the economic conference because they were attending to push for the case.
So you were stalking them.
Actually, they told us they're going a month before, and they happened to be there, and we met. Actually, met coincidentally. I mean, I can't stalk them really.
Yeah, you didn't stalk them. Okay.
Yes, that's a good term. So we pretty much sat down an hour and closed everything. So from that point on, we got the LOI, the term sheet, and everything was smooth. I mean, maybe minus the legal things. The legal stuff in Egypt really takes a lot of time, and in our case at least, although everything was correct. But they like to be quite diligent. But from that point on, everything went fine. So that's another reason why you should make sure that you have some cushion in terms of finances if things are not as fast as the Swedes do it. So,
but just to give the audience here a quick of an idea, I'm a mentor with 500 startups, and I basically blend in both landscapes, San Francisco and here. And my cousin had a startup that was acquired by Google. And the cycle took somewhere between 13 and 14 months to close. He was about to get a divorce during the cycle. And he was about to just throw the thing out two times. Because you're just stuck, you're not there, and you're not out of it. So this thing is not a Middle East specific thing. It's things take time, and you need to plan stuff. So if you already planned properly, and you know that you're going into it under this assumption, it might be much, much easier. I need to go back to the investor side and tell us a bit more on how do you see deals, especially at the growth stage? Is there a special lens that you focus on, certain traction, certain matrix that you look at? And I'm specifically a bit more interested in the governance side, the management side. I know we have, maybe you could comment a bit from your views on Do we have a crunch in terms of seasoned CEOs who are ready to take the company to the next level in the region? And what do you feel about that? Any one of you.
I'd like to propose Wave, starting from the back. So if there's really a little bit of extra people waving.
Woo!
Let's put Wave up.
Let's do it.
Do I have to do that again?
Yeah. Oh, with the video.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Good stuff. Yeah.
There's no validation.
Exactly. We need to see a little bit of that. So what we really like to see...
Does that really mean sales or any form of traction?
Any form. Whatever you decide is your success metric. This is, you said, everybody has a problem, right? You want to move on the problem. This is how I define, I'm succeeding at this problem that I identified. If you're able to accurately and clearly define that and validate it, then we're going to be interested. And then, thirdly, is just saying, okay, if I have money, X, and I'm going to get, you know, whatever it is, Y money, additional, it's going to get me to this other place, and being able to prove it. I think it's Series A, you have to have those three things very clearly in mind. Who's going to be doing what? So I think probably you guys can talk about that once you get funded. You know, the investors, you can say, okay, so this money, what are you going to do with it? And who's going to be responsible for it? It can't be just one guy, again, doing all the tasks, right?
Of course.
So number one is, what are you going to do with that money and how are you going to get there? And number two is, well, with the team. Number two is having validation of the things you have. Number three is having an idea is, okay, if I have this additional, whatever it is, $1 million or whatever it is, your Series A, $3 million, this is what I'm going to look in 6 or 12 months' time. You have to be able to plan.
And sell it as a story.
Sorry?
And sell it as a story.
Yeah, sure. I completely agree. So we also don't really go for earlier than Series A. I don't think it would be a million dollars. In the same year, you know, there has to be a very strong entrepreneur, but the team as well needs to be strong. And from our point of view, as we invest in more places, they usually don't monetize at the early stage. Series A. So what we're looking for is more critical mass in the liquidity of the marketplace. So for us, of course, that would be opposite. How many CVs do we get? How many applications do we process each month? When you see some sort of critical mass at the early stage of, you know, strong liquidity.
Something that you can map on an Excel sheet where you can see a formula of conversion,
exactly.
Or whatever.
Cool. So let's quickly now, because they gave me a signal that we're about to wrap up the panel, just walk me through post-investment, each of you. What happens? Do you call each other? Do you miss on each other? What does it look like? Is there a board resolution that happens quarterly for everything? Each of you have a different case, but tell us a bit more about it.
Well, we typically have monthly reports and quarterly meetings and ad hoc meetings in between, if there's anything, but there's not really unbearable pressure by our investors because we've laid out the strategy, discussed exactly what we have in mind, at least for the next 2 years, and if there's any risk factor or red flagged, we or they always raise it. So.
But in terms of adding value beyond the regular meetings, if you need something, a door opening and what have you.
The good thing is they have several other investments in fields that we are interested in as Yauda in terms of distribution and so on. Mm-hmm. So the very good thing about them is that they connect us with managers or CEOs of other companies that they acquire or have acquired. So we sit down together and see how to move forward. So that's a very big plus for us specifically. In terms of business as operations, we haven't had any issues up to now. I mean, we just closed a couple of months ago. So hopefully it's going to continue like that. We didn't really need anything specific or particular from our investors so far.
Okay. Danny?
So I'll share one secret with you. These investors, they love to help. I think they love it even more if you call them and say, I need this done. So
you can give them homework.
You actually give them homework. So for example, I have a calendar reminder for every 2 weeks with a list of things that I've asked each investor for. And you ask them for help, and then you track and make sure that they're actually going to help you. So all of those two-week reminders are coming from that thing.
Around the clock.
And I think it's a... The way to think of investors, especially in the region, is all of a sudden you have these amazing, amazing people that have come on board and are an extension of your team. So why would you not use them, right? And they would love to help. And they are very well connected. They have perspectives that are sometimes very different from yours because you're in the trenches trying to survive on a day-to-day basis. So use them like you would use your team members and give them homework, give them things that you need help with, and be completely open and transparent with them. They've already invested, so I think it's their money is in the business already by now. So it's not like they can take their money away. So my recommendation and advice, and this is what I've done as well every time we have brought new investors on board, give them homework and make sure that they can support it and grow the business.
I was going to say,
just a quick kickoff before you do with Beko specifically. I heard this at Property Finder. One of the reasons they loved working with you guys is that Danny, your partner, basically did a similar thing at Bait with the growing the sales team, and Mike was very much interested in your expertise in doing that. So just tell us a bit more on.
So yes, and this is along the lines of what Mudassar was saying about. They come, you know, the investors come with a set of additional expertise or other areas that that can help out. So in the case of Property Finder, yes, and Danny was there instrumental in making sure that Property Finder would increase its sales force and would expand in Saudi Arabia specifically. That was one of his main projects over the past year and a half, 2 years. But it's not it's about, as you said, you know, the team that is supposed to come with a diversified set of skill sets. So whether that is in sales, additional fundraising, maybe even business development, recruiting, whatever it is, their networks, you have to be able to use your investors. I think that's definitely key. And I'll tell you another thing: those companies that call on us more, obviously they have a bigger share of mind. If you don't call on them, you're not going to be very much up there in terms of priority, and they'll forget about you. So when you're doing the next raise, you know, it's going to be difficult to rebuild that relationship. It's a two-way relationship. It's not something that just, if you have somebody, an investor, that is just tapping you on the shoulder every other month, hey, so can you give me your monthly reports? That's not going to work. That's not a relationship that's going to work.
Yeah, so we also try to help out in any way we can with our investment, try to be on the board, but minimum, post them at least once a month, and try to help out, connect them with other investors we know, other entrepreneurs in our portfolio that we think can help them. They have things to talk about, as many of them are different types of marketplaces, but where liquidity is the main focus for all of them, and how to grow that together.
I personally try myself to beyond the regular reporting is to at least have a call every week just to make sure we're on a social relation beyond the investment relation. So even just checking on each other, and maybe if they have an issue that we can help with, or a new deal that we can help facilitate, or something like that. So I've been told we have some time, and we can take some questions from the audience. So you're eager to ask. she'll hand you a mic.
I have a question. I have two questions, actually. My name is Nida Al-Dihani. I'm from Kuwait. And I have two questions, one for the investors and one for the the heroes here. For the investors, you guys, you know that there's special condition in our region in terms of investment, especially in tech. So do you do something else in terms of investment different than tech investment, or you just like invest in tech and you wait for the result? Because I think it's going to be like a bit hard, even for your limited partner, when you go and ask for raising capital for your fund. The type of our region is kind of type you can't see the result really quickly. So how do you handle that?
I can give my perspective, but I think Bjorn, being their LP is the public markets. Yeah. That's probably of the right guy to answer that one.
I can start. So we're kind of special vehicle. We're listed on the Stockholm Stock Exchange. So we have a permanent capital. So for us, we have the affordability to be very patient in times of long-term.
So thinking. Very typical, like stock. Is there any real estate stuff like? Just
oh no. So we only invest in online marketplaces.
Alvaro, no.
Well, it's a great question, because I mean, at some point you could say we were in the Series A, yeah. Us when we were raising, right? And it and that grind really took. Well, I don't know if people here, my partner, if they know them, Danny is probably Mr. Optimism, and he was saying we're gonna be done in 4 months. Wrong. It also, even if you know everybody and their mother in this region, you're still gonna take you time.
Of course.
So what I'm trying to get to is, yes, you need that patient capital. And if you believe that investing in tech, especially at the stage of development where we are today, that you're gonna see a flip in the ways that you see in Silicon Valley within 18 to 24 months, you better go to Silicon Valley, because that's not gonna happen here. You need to be patient.
Things take time.
Kareem, if this question has any sensitivity, feel free don't answer it. For the $72 million, is it cool to mention the companies that they put this $72 million?
Yeah, sure. The names are publicly known, but we have Abraj Group. Okay. We have Altayar Travel Group. We have Beko Capital, of course. And Saudi Telecom Ventures, Endure Capital, Wamda, Kuwait Investment Authority.
Okay.
So we are carrying the region's pride on us. The entire region is invested in us now. So. You should consider deleting the other app that you have on your device.
You are uniting the Arabic nation.
The second part of the question is, since all of these beautiful money came in your back. Sure.
Can we see the lady here, please? Hidayat, how many questions can we take? Okay.
I'm Zainab Nawar. I'm an economist from the British University here in Egypt.
From
the British University.
Okay.
Yes. I'm just asking for you as entrepreneurs. I'm just asking them all. What do you feel that would be the added value as you work as an entrepreneur for the economy? I mean, I know there is an employment. I know there is money coming in, but sometimes there is money also coming out when you have another multinational just buying your idea. So all the money is going to another country, whatever. So what do you see that entrepreneurs is adding to the economy? I'm addressing this question because I'm an economist. I'm very interested to know what would be the added value behind the entrepreneurs who are working in Egypt.
I think there needs to be a complete panel on that, but maybe
yes.
They can take a shot.
Just a hint, small hint about it.
I can do a 3-day workshop regarding
yes. What is behind the employment, knowledge transfer, taxes has been paid? What else?
So simply look at the Maktoub deal. Maktoub basically took place, was it 2009? And Endeavor has done a fantastic job in creating a map on the relationship between the people who made money out of the Maktoub deal and how they reinvested most of it into the ecosystem. So Samiha and Hussam created Jabbar Internet Group. Others basically, someone like Khalid Jabassini, who exited just during the deal, started investing as well. And each of them basically either took out, based on the talent they have, they created other companies, or they either angel invested or created a VC group. So there's an economical, high impact economical cycle that takes place beyond the job creation. It's a complete cycle. You learn, you exit, you move to somewhere else within the ecosystem, and you start contributing back, and the cycle keeps going on. But I'm not sure if any of you would like to.
Not sure about the Saudi one that you're referring to, but I think just building on what Tariq is, Rami is saying, it does create an amazing, trickle effect. If you have one success like a Maktoub, it does inspire and create a role model for many others to follow suit. So if you ask many of the kids in Silicon Valley, why are they doing what they're doing? You know, a lot of them will tell you, hey, I want to be the Zuckerberg, I want to be the Bill Gates, I want to be the Steve Jobs. And that does create a lot of inspiration, that creates more economic activity, and then that creates more reason for investors to invest, and then the whole thing just starts ballooning and creates places like the Silicon Valley. We're at the early stages of this. I think Maktoub has been a fantastic landmark for the region. I think inshallah, if we have a few more, the whole region will start to look different, and there is an amazing opportunity right now to basically lead to its development.
Dasser, while you're at it, just we want everyone to give a closing remark before we end off. So if you have any closing words.
So since the topic is raising money, I think my recommendation is focusing on developing an amazing product that will deliver value to your customers and delight your customers, and then focus on growing that. Money will come. Money is a byproduct if you're doing well as a business. So make sure that you focus on the core business and grow the core business. If you don't do that, money will not come.
For entrepreneurs, I would say that you probably need to be obsessed with your startup. That's actually saying the right word for a
super,
long time.
Super obsessed.
Super obsessed, yeah. Number one. Investors, I mean, I've heard a lot of interesting things from regional regional and international investors. Unfortunately, we don't have anyone from Egypt on the panel, but I mean, it would be interesting to see the differences between both, because as you've seen specifically this and last year, many of the investments in the Egyptian companies or startups are coming from abroad. It might be interesting to see the difference in terms of priorities for both local and international slash regional investors. I cannot generalize definitely, but I would say that some local investors look more on the quick wins, fast returns, be profitable in 2 years. That's not necessarily very, very realistic, specifically in Egypt. So I think, as you said, that's probably a panel on its own, but that's just a quick note from my side.
Well, on the concept of, or the subject of raising funds, I would say definitely you have to diligence the investors that you will approach. And even though you might be very busy on running the day-to-day job, whether it's somebody on your board, whether it's somebody in your management team, somebody has to really do their homework in terms of who you're going to approach. You're not going to go to the bank and ask for a SIM card. So in the same way, you know, make sure that whoever you're approaching, you're targeting, is really within, let's say, the investor universe for your specific company.
Bjorn?
Yeah, definitely. Make sure that you get money from the right investor, not just anyone. So two-way partnership. And as an international investor, I guess, coming here, we didn't have any experience of Egypt. So apart from having a great story, great business, it's good that you prepare and, you know, really educate us international investors coming to Egypt of how things work, whether it's legal or financial, et cetera, et cetera.
Okay. So next year with the Rise Up, I hope we will flip the panel. We'll have the full theater filled up with companies going through Series A. Now you know the tricks, so you need to learn how to do that. And we'll have the audience sitting here, a few just picking up the ideas. Thank you guys for joining me in this panel. Thank you for attending, and hopefully you'll enjoy the rest of Rise Up.